One more time, make some noise for the guys while they find their seats here.
Yeah, pump up the volume.
This is very awesome and an honor to have all you guys here. You know, to the people at home, everyone in the room just got a special sneak peek of what's to come on Sunday. We were all enjoying it and laughing at it. I want to talk about the current season, but I want to go back to the beginning real quick. Where did the idea, the seedling for this crazy show come from when you guys were putting it together? How did you build this world and conceive of this?
Chris had a really amazing idea for this sort of afterlife that's based on, extreme Muslim beliefs.
And, great place to start.
Great place that's to start. Fantastic.
Mind that for comedy. Let's go deep into that.
All of the biggest ideas.
It's an afterlife with a bunch of virgins and like a river of cotton candy and a tree that grew pad thai and stuff. But yes, go on.
Anyways, Muslims are super. No. Can we start over? Can we do the whole thing when we come out?
You want to go back in? Yeah.
We travel back in time.
Can we do it? I'm hearing no. No, this is it. We're committed to this now.
Anyways, we did this thing called 1,000 Virgins, and we did it for Super Deluxe back in, we're famous. Hey. super famous. Justin Timberlake. Hey.
I think they got free bathrooms in there.
Yeah, so we did this thing for Super Deluxe, and we loved it, and we pitched it to Adult Swim, and, you know, it sort of languished there for a while, but then they finally took a chance on it after Mr. Too Many Cooks blew it up.
Yeah, we'll get to that, yeah.
Yeah.
Well, you guys, I mean, you've been in this game for a while. You're sort of the masters of the 12 to 15-minute format and cultivating, like, these great stories in a condensed period of time.
Micro TV, yes.
Micro TV, yes. For sure. Is there anything, was this always conceived from the beginning as micro TV, or did you just find that that format lends itself to the stories you guys like to tell and the jokes you write and stuff like that?
Actually, on this, we tried making it a half hour, but... As Dave will say,
these guys couldn't sustain.
Yeah, micro actors could not sustain.
I can only act for 45
seconds. Turns out it's twice as hard to do 22 minutes as it is to do 11 minutes. Yeah. Fair
enough. Dave calls it like a baklava. Like if a shorter thing, it's just you can make it denser and denser. Nice.
And some people are deathly allergic to baklava, the baklava that we make. In short, I think that time slot was available. And
we can fill
so
it.
We
can
filled
we put
it
a commercial
with as much
or your show.
Yeah.
I think you made the right call. I think perfect. I want to run down the line because you guys, the cast, everyone, everything on this show, everyone's clearly firing on all cylinders. Henry, I want to start with you, man. A big fan of the last podcast on the left, by the way.
Woo! Thank you.
Yeah.
To the podcast.
It's good to hear. It's good to hear. We have a bunch of people here who came in because of the free bathrooms. And because of the podcast, which I think is really very nice.
Is this? Did someone leave this, or is this for me?
If they don't sip it, we do keep it on stage from the last one.
But that's fine. Joey McIntyre was up here before.
That's Joey McIntyre water.
Film to it.
Well, that's the McIntyre special, right?
You just had to pinch the skin off, and then it's perfectly good.
And he's got a sampling of my older sister's entire generation's DNA all over his body.
Henry, what I wanted to ask you, jumping off the podcast point, is this show kind of feels like, and maybe I'm wrong, but it feels like a dream role for you and sort of in your wheelhouse. How did you get to be Gary? How did you get involved with these guys, man?
They chose me because I think higher up people on the chain in the acting world did not come to the audition. I just auditioned for it and I got it, and thankfully they chose me. Thankfully, they chose me. Both of you did. I need this job. I need to keep this job. I don't know how it all kind of worked out because I was doing last podcast at the time and just kind of, I will label it towards a synchronicity that can be attributed to chaos magic.
When we got the auditions, we just picked him first because he's got such a Mad Magazine type name, Zebrowski.
Yeah. Yeah, my agent wanted me to change it. She said it was too ethnic and no one would understand it.
I mean, but the fact that we found out later that he was an amateur Satanist, it just worked out.
He didn't know that. I don't know if that would have affected you adversely to hiring me if you found out my
hey, like a real technical advice, like, it would never look like this. His office would never be like this. You're doing it all wrong.
It was supposed to be cold because of the absence of God's light. No, I have many pewter rings.
Real precious about the hell.
Yes.
You were brought in as the consultant, basically, and then just worked your way into the role.
Yeah. I took a pay cut to act.
Yeah. Matt, I want to talk to you about your portrayal of Satan. You bring this gravitas and sort of boiling just under the surface vibe that I love. Are you channeling any prior bosses that you knew of or met in your lifetime? Or how did you go about bringing them to life in this fashion? And this is your Satan.
I'm channeling a lot of bitterness that I've ended up on this show, that my career has brought me to this moment.
Yeah, I noticed you didn't call this his the role of a lifetime.
Yeah, yeah. Let's be clear. This is just a rest stop along
Matt,
the way.
Matt, I've seen you in bigger and better things.
Yeah.
I mean, in my defense, the guy was on the freaking Sopranos. It's hard for me to to say the least.
I said.
But yeah, I think what you're bringing to Satan comes from all the different roles I've seen you play and all the different things you've done. So bitter or not, you're using that energy well, is what I would say as a viewer from my perspective.
I also have to stay sober for about 10 hours to do the show, because if you drink a lot, the makeup comes off, kind of melts off. So there's a lot of that kind of angry sobriety going on.
And he loses his balance on this.
Yeah.
Yeah, you're resting on two stilts. Yeah. Like, if you want to pretend you're Matt, go home, get two empty coffee cans, walk around, strap them to your feet, walk around on those with, like, Afghan around your legs for about 12 hours.
I don't think the audience knows, for three seasons, I have been wearing, like, 10-inch heels that make me taller than everybody, and I've got hooves. I'm, like, half man, half goat. So I wear yak pants, which make me very hot, and all that 2 hours in a makeup chair, and then I'm wearing 10-inch heels. So I sort of sympathize with, like, the strippers at the yeah. You know.
And I've heard him give Gene that Simmons. Speech to strippers.
Yes. We talk shop.
We're
like,
Jersey.
So what do you put gel, like, you know, Dr. Scholl's in your clear-heeled stripper shoes?
Also, he can confirm that he has these fingernails that will come off very easily, so if between takes he has to go to the bathroom, you need assistance.
That's true.
Is that
I have claws. Yeah, so at one point we were going to get somebody who literally was going to wrangle my penis. Like, they would have to help me go to the bathroom because I couldn't. The first time I went to the bathroom and held with the claws, I shredded it.
And just Turner loved hearing about this. Turner Broadcasting loves to hear every single bit of the.
What exactly are we building? What are we building here? I'm not sure what we're building here. Are we building
careers? From what I understand, penis wrangler seems to still be available. Okay. I'm reading that story right.
Yeah.
That's how Dana started on Aqua Teen as penis.
Which
that's
brings
how
we us to just
very strange. Here we go.
Perfect segue.
Here we go.
Because you can't
down.
See. Yeah. You can't see anybody. You know what I mean?
Realize I was animated till like season three. Thought it was very important stuff.
Dana, first of all, yes, thank you for the voice of Master Shane.
You're welcome.
Yeah, okay, good. I wanted to, we see you a little bit in the first season, not so much in the second. You're back in the third. What happened second season that made you leave, and what brought you back, man?
Well, I don't know. I was a guy on the first one.
Yeah.
And then I couldn't come back. Well, I was the roommate. What was his name? Lucas.
Well,
Lucas.
In Lucas. Fairness, then, you weren't written back.
Yeah, he was not
Dana
asked back.
Dana just kind of showed up.
Yeah.
Your coworker for years did not put
Dave
it
Dave told
the
me
next
to
show.
Go screw myself. And then he needed me. Then he called me. Desperate. He was begging, pleading. Please. The ratings are dropping. I'm like the kid on All in the Family when Archie Bunker had the baby. Bring in the new to revitalize the series.
You're the Raven Simone of our series. Yeah.
You're the Raven Simone.
Yeah, right. Yeah, exactly.
You know, I know it's weird to talk about you like this because you're sitting right in front of me, but you have one of those voices that is just everything you say is kind of inherently funny. You said he wasn't written in the first one. Is Dana one of those?
No, he's not funny. It's his voice.
Exactly.
It's his voice that does all the work.
But do you find yourself just kind of throwing Dana into things? It's like, oh, I need that voice. I need Dana's voice.
No.
No, not at all.
No.
No.
Who says that?
No. I try to get away from
his
that
wife
voice.
Doesn't
no
say
one
that.
Has,
his
no.
kids don't say.
No.
Yeah.
We touched briefly. You guys mentioned the makeup. You said 2 hours in a chair, your yak pants, and all that stuff. The makeup, for what it's worth the time because it's incredible. Were there any regrets as the reality of the requirements for the makeup began to set in?
They have no regrets.
Yeah,
They love it. I honestly really like it, but I also think I have a sort of, let's say, sexual awareness to discomfort. And I think that's what's happened over time. I don't know if I've just grown, my body's adapted to like the makeup and attribute it in a weird sort of sexual way to myself. And so it's like I'm constantly rewarding myself by being uncomfortable. You know what I mean? Like a guy who lives in those like rubber balls who has like a scuba thing coming out of the top of it.
Oh, he's the just bubble
like,
boy.
Yeah, and you're like, just hold the top of it closed.
The guy with the latex fetish, who just has like a breathing hole.
Yeah.
Yeah, the latex people.
Yeah, yeah. Ghost people.
Yeah.
I feel like I'm becoming a latex person without the cool attitude.
He walks around with a snorkel. You're just on set with a snorkel.
Hey, guys, choke me out. Hey.
It is cancer causing though. I mean that makeup is truly. I think the third ingredient is cancer. After like red.
Isn't it like red dye number three?
Isn't that like?
Yeah. It's called Cajun red, right?
It's called Cajun red.
At the very least, it lowers your sperm count. That's the minimum that it does.
We're all sterile now.
Well, then it's already on, right?
Yeah.
Well,
yeah.
Yeah.
No gloves.
Is that what led to you being shirtless and completely red in one of the most recent episodes?
They just like to do that. They just like to show my body. It's also nothing like Shane Morton and Chris Brown's true joy in getting to paint my nipples because they like to do it with the... Because our body's normally alcohol-based paint, so it doesn't come off as much. But they do as a favor to me, so I don't have to scour my entire body with 99% alcohol in order to take it off. They just put the water-based stuff on my body, but the problem is that it drips off me because it's 110 degrees inside of the studio, and so I'm just like a giant, like, salty ice cream cone.
This is why we don't have a live audience. We could be filmed in front of a live, but we're not.
No.
Because of your sweaty boobs.
Yeah, because it just drips off.
Well, anywhere where skin's touching skin, then the makeup just immediately comes off.
Yes, because it's underneath my tits is where the space where it rubs the most. And then all of a sudden I'll have these weird, like, inverse negative shadows, like, of just human skin underneath it. And then they're like, we're seeing it in the folds. And then, like, literally Shane had to come over and, like paint me like I'm one of his French girls.
Yeah. What I love though is that they're at the monitors and they'll go, I'm seeing and we're just like, hey, just leave it.
It's fine. It's fine.
But it's cool to look in the mirror and not see yourself. I think that there is definitely a magic moment when you look in the and you are literally another character and you can't recognize yourself. Plus, I hate the way I look.
I feel like was the shower after that like the hallway scene from The Shining, just like you.
We stay at those hotel rooms, they all look like murder scenes by the end of the month. Yeah. They're like, the sheets are all red, the walls are red. You could, the light switch, it's like
we've tried to
show.
Explain to the maids, many of whom don't speak English, what we're doing there, and then we just give up. We're like, we just pay them a lot of money, keep your mouth shut. They change the sheets every day.
Or you don't wash it all. You're like, oh, going through the grocery store, the guys are like, your ears are bleeding, you have red nostrils.
And they think it's normal. They act like that's like a common thing to be like, hey, man, your ears are bleeding. Like, it's like I'm not patient zero in the new super plague.
Yeah. I mean, that's death within minutes if your ears are bleeding.
I like to bring the maids in and I go, I'm changing, and like writhe in front of the big pink bathtub. I'm becoming a woman.
Dave, Casper, I want to ask you.
Go back to the front row.
We're just going to come back here for a second. Part of the fun of the show is how everyone's kind of blasé and bored with the grotesque minutiae that comes along with being in hell. As you guys are coming up with these ideas, has there ever been a moment where you've gotten to set, seen something from the paper, realized, and gone, oh wow, that's a lot more intense than it was in my head? Or is it exactly the aesthetic you're going for every time?
Oh, that's a tough question. I think we pulled some of the aesthetic from just working at William Street at Turner and like part of the Time Warner, like, mega corporation. You know,
family. You wanted to use the word family.
Yes. AOL. Time
Turner
family.
Yeah, the Turner family of networks.
I think we've all attended, like, whenever you work there for 5 years, you get this, like, lucite plaque, and we were just like, well, what if that was a 800-pound spiked ball that you had to get fastened to your calf, you know? I mean, we just amplify it a little bit.
Well, in the first season, you waterboarded Claude, and then when we were working out with special effects, they're like, we kind of got to do it for real, and they literally, like, put him up in this thing, and it was a funny ending to an episode on paper, and then
we got into
Craig,
edit, and we were like,
I am literally drowning. Like, he is tied to a thing, drowning.
He's already a hypochondriac, too, so
it was definitely, like, and they were like, this isn't funny. Like, they're watching him, like, be tortured, and they're also like, and this is why, again, if the torture was funny, we could still call them advanced interrogation techniques instead of a torture. I mean, if it was funny in the moment.
Yeah, we were running long, so we cut it. But
you did, right? You did cut it. That's what's even tragic. We shot it and then they cut it. So he got waterboarded for nothing. That's for his art.
He's gotten super liberal since then, too. Like, he's real liberal.
Well, if there's one thing that gives you perspective. Believes in all these rights and... It's, you know, and that kind of dovetails nicely into the next question. Adult Swim is notoriously, like, the safe space for weird shit, for lack of a better term, and, like, really different styles of humor and dark humor and absurd humor and all these great things. And I know this may be a crazy question based on the history of the show, but if there is a line, if there is a limit to what you guys can do, how did you find it and then circumvent it at some point or work your way around it? Or has there not?
S&P tells you.
Yeah, S&P sends an email that says the feces cannot look like, cannot be of a brown shade.
You or can
like,
eat
well, what
the feces,
kind of, what color?
But you can't say it's feces. Or you can call it feces, but you can't eat it.
He can eat the feces, but we can't watch him put it in his mouth.
Yeah, that's
and
right.
Stuff like that. And you can say the D word for the penis, but you can't say the C word for the penis. I've been told that several times.
Art, another example is the episode you guys just saw. Like, we were like, can we show this woman just straddling Gary and hopping on him? I think in the back of my head, well, if we can't show that, we'll just comp a photocopier in front to cover it up. But no, apparently on the network of Tom and Jerry and Scooby-Doo, in the evenings, we can just show softcore.
You don't see any penetration. It's like, that's. I think that would be the big thing.
You said that like you were disappointed. You don't see any penetration.
Not for lack of trying
for
Henry.
I went through the whole thing, and they don't show it.
They're all laughing and stuff. I'm having sex.
And they're filming it.
I've got to know then, what were the conversations surrounding when you guys did the Heaven episode and Henry's literally shitting demons? What were the notes that led you to, oh, well, you can do this. This is fine.
Let's get another take. Take your pants down faster this time. Really grab your ankles.
What I love, too, is that we had
angle
whole
scenes.
Angle
your butt towards the camera.
We had whole scenes that got cut from that so you guys could include more footage of my ass. And also, the worst is just... grips, having to get my feet into position where I'm hanging with my pants completely off of balcony. And two grips are holding my hands and my feet are hooked into a thing. I'm like spread. And so they have to like shoot it from an angle where you cannot see the hole. Like you can't see the hole. You could see all the rest of my accoutrement, but you cannot see that part. And so they have to shoot all these angles and I keep buzzing like grips and sound guys like with my whole b-hole and they're all like because it's not like Olivia Wilde, you know, like it's me ruining everyone's day, hours of it. And then I remember like Keith, our boss's boss, like came in and then it was like literally been like, things are going well here, like me just like fully nude hanging off
Hang on, let's get it mic'd. There's no reason to mic that.
Henry, we're going to need you to ADR all these scenes.
Let's put some tape. Let's tape that mic down.
You guys are doing God's work. Casper, so I said earlier that we'd get into the whole too many cooks thing. It was a freaking phenomenon, right? One of the big questions that I had about that was... did the level to which the shockwave traveled exceed your expectations? I remember at one point CNN did a parody with all the Republican candidates, which they were trying. But the point is, like, that video, it was massive. I was just wondering what that was like from your side, this fun little project that you guys did, and now here it was being talked over the world over.
It was totally a surprise, and I think it just was like 6 months where I just had too much adrenaline, like an uncomfortable amount of adrenaline. It was really amazing, and one of the exciting things was like so many people I admire like it, so you know they would reach out to me, and you know I could meet them, you know, yeah. Which was amazing.
What's one of the people that you're really grateful you got to meet out of that experience?
our Jack Black or the guys that do Peep Show, like Jesse Armstrong. I'm a huge fan of those guys. And, yeah, stuff like our Ryan Johnson.
Your parents came and finally met you.
Yeah, my parents. Right? My parents finally accepted me. So it was all worth it.
That's what it took.
It was really weird. It's like we were writing together, and then it dropped, and then, like, I remember looking at like in the middle of the night going, oh my God, like millions of hits like in a day, you know, and then the next day I lost him in the writer's room. Like we were working together, and for 2 days he was like, the PR people would grab him at the beginning of the day and go, it's the president. And he just looked in the middle, he was just staring in the middle distance. I could just tell he was just shell shocked, yeah. You know?
And you guys referenced it early in the beginning, but had it opened up doors for you to do other projects and things that you loved? Like now you could walk into a room and you could pitch an idea, and if they weren't into it, you could be like, well, too many cooks. Like, did it really
it's,
help?
It's cracked some doors open. Yes, yeah. I think so. Yeah. I'm working on a movie. Very cool. So yeah.
It also closed some doors, I think, too. Yeah.
Some doors.
We're going to turn in just a second to audience Q&A, but I have one more somewhat self-indulgent question I got to ask you guys about. There was an album that came out, 05, that Adult Swim released. It was Danger Doom and MF Doom and Danger Mouse did this amazing collaboration. And some of the interludes that you guys have on there are pretty hilarious and pretty amazing. I'm wondering what those sessions were like and then what your response was when you finally heard everything cut together the way they did it for the first time and what you thought of that thing.
You first.
I didn't even know what the hell it was. No. Vishal was like, oh, yeah, they have some extra thing you have to record after the episode of Aqua Teen. We didn't have a script. We were just like, oh, they're going to be voicemail messages to some guy I never heard of.
Much. You have to know Vishal. I mean, he's kind of a chiseler.
Yeah.
He would say.
He was like, we can pay you $13 extra dollars for this. And then, like.
This won't be your episode, right?
Yeah, yeah. And then, like, 2 months later, my brother's like, wow, that album you did is awesome. Like, the what? What is it? He goes, yeah, it's a record. It's 2 greatest dudes in the universe. You guys are all on it. It's like, what the hell are you talking about?
Yeah, I didn't know a thing about it. They were just like, let's get you in the booth. Just say some stuff about rap music. You know, it's fine. I was like, what's this for? Is it a voicemail or something? It's
like, something
yeah, just something like that. Yeah, just do some.
My outgoing message.
Yeah.
I sure do like me some rap music.
Yeah, right.
Is that got it?
Well, thank you for that. That's the exact response I could have hoped for. Let's go ahead, open it up to the audience. I see some mics out there. First one looks like it's right here.
Hey, guys. I was wondering, if you did end up in hell, who in your life would you want to bring with you there?
Oh, wait a minute. Hell, that's like a two. My that's God. Like a double-sided, because do I want to torture someone else? Down yeah, there with me, like if I'm gonna have to do it, I'm gonna bring an enemy of mine down. So if I'm gonna get, you know, red hot pokers up my ass all the time or whatever, at least I'm also gonna see this guy I can't stand also get that happen. Yeah. Or it would be the opposite, that then they treat him nice.
Well, right, because it's your
so it's
hell,
like torture.
Right?
Yeah.
I think I'd bring someone I want tortured with me.
Yeah, I feel like you got to, right?
Yeah, I think it'd be me and Dick Cheney. And it would just be me just grinding on Dick Cheney's lap. Be like, you like it?
It's not bad.
He's actually kind of soft.
That sounds like an episode, I think. Write it down.
All right.
I'm going to pick Henry because he's already established he sexually enjoys discomfort. So I figure.
Yeah, you see me looking like a little hors d'oeuvre. So
I keep saying that Hell is a show about hell that never ends. I think we'll be like coming back to, we'll be just sitting like this, or maybe not. Maybe we never age. We just keep doing the show over.
How big is the boulder going in my ass?
Yeah, and Chris and I will be like, I feel like we've done the boulder up the ass before. Can we,
season
is there something else we could put up his ass?
Maybe some licorice, something thinner.
I just feel like the ass is done. We've done the ass.
A driverless car, that's new.
It's the size of a boulder. It's the same.
I look forward to that episode of Your Pretty Face is Going to Hell. Next question right over here, microphone.
Yeah, hey guys. I was just wondering, like, was there any parts of filming where it just went too far? Like, you know, like where you just had to say one joke and then it just kept going and going?
I mean, you heard everything Henry said about doing the show, right? Hanging with his ass.
But that was scripted.
That's true. Well, you guys do a lot of extra, you know, throwing different jokes in, switching them out with...
Meaning, do they go on too long and we have to cut it? Usually we just sort of fake laugh until it's over.
Yeah, that's the idea. Well, but that's what we like.
We look at each other, we go, we'll cut this.
Just me screaming in the background with a goat and like all this other shit going on. And then they're like,
when are they going to go cut? Should we just keep talking more stuff?
Yeah, like everybody's gone to lunch and we're still like doing a bit up here. I'm like, the cameras? Yeah.
I believe we have time for one more question. It's going to be right over here.
Hey, guys. So I'm just curious, what is the weirdest thing that's ever happened to you on set, whether it was scripted or completely accidental?
Weirdest.
Matt, you can invoke the Sopranos.
Is this the time I transition? Well, that's funny you should ask. In the second season of Sopranos, yeah. Like, yeah.
On set, the thing is that, you know, the bar is high.
Yeah.
In terms of, we're already doing a lot of, like, unusual stuff. You're already kind of, it's, like, already, like, a big thing. So it's, like, it's more like the, there's just stories I shouldn't tell. There's some stories I shouldn't tell. It's also, like, you know, we
you
also just hire.
A butthole story? Like, there's something beyond that?
Yeah. It's, like, we just hire drifters.
Those you should probably not tell.
Yes, the BG on there, a lot of our background guys are like legitimately like pulled from Fulton Industrial Highway. Like they're like, I heard you guys got free food. And they're like, put them in paint.
$75. Get him a SAG card.
Yeah. Yeah, right. Exactly.
So they have a lot of weird stories. And weird happenings with them, with their bodies. And they're around. They're just like they're in and around eating food with you. And they're like, the guy was just like, you ever have shooting pains up your penis? Like, you have this like long thing, but like, sometimes it feels like there's an electric eel inside of me. And I'm like, just trying to eat chicken, just being like, I have 45 minutes apiece. Sir, please.
But I think my children coming and watching this process was the most surreal thing for me. My kids came to set last season, and this episode hasn't aired yet, and I don't want to give it away, but it was when you and I were in my office sliding all over the place, and just whack-a-doodle. And so I leave them alone for about, I don't know, 20 minutes. We're shooting this stuff. They finally getting to see what their dad does for a living. I look out. Shane has spray painted my children red and put horns on them.
They're all monstered up. It was really fun.
Yeah, that was actually. I mean, they still talk about it. I sort of like they had no interest in show business until. So like, wait, you get to wear the makeup and the horns and be wacky. And they were very impressed with the free food.
Yeah,
they're like, so this table of food, you can take this anytime.
They're like, I can have the soda. It's like, yeah, you can have the soda. It's like, I can have these Slim Jims. It's like. Yeah, you can have anything.
I'm going into show business.
So,
see, listen, that's why we're here, I think, right? For the Slim Jims and soda.
I had two sodas in the green room back there.
You did?
You did. Yeah.
I cast my son as the victim of a pedophile on the show. What is a pedo? Daddy will explain in about 3 years, maybe. Well, we were talking about it. We were like, we can't sit in a casting session for this part.
Yeah, you just as drunk as being like, be more vulnerable.
Undo another button.
You know, that's how Lou Pearlman put together the Backstreet Boys.
I got to hand it to you. You made it to, we almost finished the show without that story, but you got it in there. You found a way. Yeah.
My son played a pedophile.
Don't let me tell. No, we're going to get it in there, and we did. So thank you for that. And guys, thank you not only for this show, but for collectively for the years of incredible and hilarious television you provided us with. It's your pretty face is going to hell Sunday at 11:30 on Adult Swim. Guys, join me one more time in thanking everyone for being here. Dave, Kathy, Anthony, Matt, Dana. Give it up, guys.
Thank you.